من يهدي الله فلا مضل له، ومن يضلل فلا هادي له، ولا حول ولا قوة إلا بالله العلي العظيم. وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، وأشهد أن محمدًا عبده ورسوله وصفوته من خلقه وحبيبه، قد بلغ الرسالة وأدى الأمانة ونصح الأمة وكشف الغمة وجاهد في سبيل دينه حتى أتاه اليقين. فاللهم اجزه عنا وعن والدينا وعن الإسلام والمسلمين خير ما جازيت به نبيا عن قومه ورسولا عن أمته. اللهم أحينا على سنته وأمتنا على ملته، واحشرنا تحت لوائه وأوردنا حوضه، واسقنا من يده الشريفة شربة هنيئة لا نظمأ بعدها أبدا. اللهم أمين. As we have been trying to examine what the Quran says to people, الناس, mankind, and what the Quran says about mankind, we come across ayat that makes us stop and think. We tend to render judgments. We tend to say, people are this, people are that, people cannot do this, people, and in reality, we are expressing our experience with people. We are reflecting on our own experience with people. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when Allah talks about people, it is not about his experience with people, it is about him being the creator. He knows the ins and the outs. إِنَّهُ عَلِيمٌ بِذَاتُ الصُّدُورِ عَلَّامُ الْغُيُوبِ. He knows all what's hidden, and he knows the inner soul and the inner hearts of every single human being. So when he talks about people, nothing comes but the truth, the ultimate truth. And when he talks to people, again, it is the same. He addresses them with truth and for the purpose of delivering and guiding them to truth as it should be. So we went over the portion where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala spoke to us saying, يَا أَيُّهَا النَّاسِ اُعْبُدُوا رَبَّكُمُ الَّذِي خَلَقَكُمْ وَالَّذِينَ مِنْ قَبْلِكُمْ لَعَلَّكُمْ تَتَّقُونَ. And we went over that set of ayat. Then today we are moving beyond those ayat to capture something else, another perspective that we need to pay attention to. Here in ayah number 26 in Surah Al-Baqarah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that Allah does not shy to set forth a parable of a gnat. Allah does not shy. Nothing stops Allah from using any of his creature, no matter how minute or minimal or insignificant it may be. You know, the Quran spoke about bees. The Quran spoke about the web. The Quran spoke about ants. The Quran is talking here about the gnat, ba'uda, fama fawqaha, and whatever is smaller than a gnat, which means what? What is this? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying to people that as much as you are thinking of yourself as very important, very big, very intelligent, very complicated, look at those examples and see if you think of yourself still as great. And if you like, Allah can pick even a smaller animal or insect or anything to give and use as an example. In the Quran, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, فَلَا تَضْرِبُوا لِلَّهِ الْأَمْثَالِ. Don't you offer Allah examples or parables or simile, because Allah knows everything. Some of us, when we read an ayah from the Quran and we don't understand it or we don't get the point behind it, we start discussion without knowing what the ayah is talking about. One of our ways of discussion is to push our examples. Suppose Allah says this, and why Allah doesn't say that? Allah saying, فَلَا تَضْرِبُوا لِلَّهِ الْأَمْثَالِ. Why? إِنَّ اللَّهَ يَعْلَمُ وَأَنْتُمْ لَا تَعْلَمُونَ. When it comes to knowledge, of man, the knowledge that we collect, Allah knows and we know nothing. When it comes to knowledge that Allah provides us, it is real knowledge that matters. And it matters for our survival, for our living, for our safety, and for our fate in the hereafter. So His knowledge is the ultimate knowledge. So don't try to offer Allah examples against what He wants you to do, or against what He is commanding you to do. So here, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is offering the gnat, the ba'uda, as an example. And He is quoting to us the reaction of people. The reaction of people is, فَأَمَّا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا فَيَعْلَمُونَ أَنَّهُ الْحَقَّ مِنْ رَبِّهِمْ. As far as those who believed, they know that it is the truth from Allah. You know that the eye of the gnat has been studied. And one day, inshallah, I will get you the video showing and talking about this. But it is on the internet. You could search it. It's amazing. Just the eye of the gnat, the eye of the camel is a miracle. Everything Allah creates is a miracle. Whether the product is huge as an animal, or bigger like a mountain, or as small as an ant, or a gnat, or a mosquito, anything. There is nothing big for Allah, and there is nothing that we should see as insignificant. If it is created by Allah, it has miracles in it. All what we need to do is study. And this is how we raise and develop our faith in Allah and our faith in His book. So the purpose here is not to list ayat and things and text for us to just read. The purpose is to reflect. بَعُوضَةً فَمَا فَوْقَهَا. Here, it doesn't mean what is above it. Because in the Arabic language, when you say هذا شيء صغير, somebody could say but أكثر من ذلك أو أكبر من ذلك means أصغر. So it is the opposite of what you get from the literal text. So فما فوقها means whatever is smaller than a gnat. It could also become a proper parable used by Allah to show us how much humble we should be. How much humble we should be. Those insects, they have communities like ours. إِلَّا أُمَمٌ أَمْثَالُكُمْ. They communicate, they talk. We have heard what the ant said to its community when Solomon was walking with his army, right? لَا يَحْتِمَنَّكُمْ سُلَيْمَانُ وَجُنُودُهُ وَهُمْ لَا يَشْعُرُونَ. They don't only talk, but they think. And they can assign blame. And they can render an innocent verdict. Say, Suleiman is innocent. وَهُمْ لَا يَشْعُرُونَ. So this is a very developed insect. This is not just an ant that is insignificant and it's meaningless. لَا يَحْتِمَنَّكُمْ سُلَيْمَانُ وَجُنُودُهُ وَهُمْ لَا يَشْعُرُونَ. She's offering an excuse. That's a sophisticated animal, insect. It's a very sophisticated creature. So here, فَأَمَّا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا فَيَعْلَمُونَ أَنَّهُ الْحَقُّ مِنْ رَبِّهِمْ. So the believers, when Allah speaks, they know this is truth. Period. Finished. There is no analysis. So you don't need to study and become a scientist in every field to appreciate what Allah is saying. It's enough that He said it to become truth. فَأَمَّا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا فَيَعْلَمُونَ أَنَّهُ الْحَقُّ مِنْ رَبِّهِمْ وَأَمَّا الَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا. And these are the two sides of the division of humanity. فَمِنْكُمْ كَافِرٌ وَمِنْكُمْ مُؤْمِنٌ. Here, the ayah is exposing the reaction, the difference of reaction. When Allah speaks, how the believers react. When someone else speaks, how they react. وَأَمَّا الَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا فَيَقُولُونَ مَاذَا أَرَادَ اللَّهُ بِهَذَا مَثَلًا. What did Allah really mean by using the gnat as an example. An example for what? It's an example of a very small insect in which cells, every cell is a miracle. Every cell is a miracle. If you imagine this process, what Allah is actually talking about, if you are a student of biology, could you ever answer, how does a new cell move to where it belongs and form the specific cell that belongs to a liver or belongs to a kidney or belongs to the lung or any other organ? How does it do it? No, it doesn't do it on its own. الَّذِي أَعْطَى كُلَّ شَيْءٍ خَلْقَهُ ثُمَّ هَدَى. Allah is the one who gave everything its nature as a creature, and He guided all what He created as to where to be and what to do. Very important. رَبُّنَا الَّذِي أَعْطَى كُلَّ شَيْءٍ خَلْقَهُ ثُمَّ هَدَى. Who guides the birds in the early morning to wake up at Fajr time and start singing the praise of Allah? You hear them, right? Who guided them to where to find their food? Where is the better weather? How do birds fly thousands of miles between winter and summer, south and north, to change weather and to follow the season that is most fit for their development, for growing their children, their chickens? So we have to be very aware that nothing small is really small in the eyes of Allah. Everything has its own miracle. And if we think, and this is why scholars have said that the most lost ibadah on Muslims is ibadah tafakkur, the worship that comes in the form of reflection, pondering, thinking, analyzing, learning, inquiring. That is lost because we're too busy. Day in and day out, we are only answering triggers and signals and responding and reacting to things because we're not busy. We're not busy to think on our own. So if you have few minutes every day to reflect on the creation of Allah, it really does increase your faith a lot. So, وَأَمَّا الَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا فَيَقُولُونَ مَاذَا أَرَادَ اللَّهُ بِهَذَا مَثَلًا يُضِلُّ بِهِ كَثِيرًا. The kafirin responding and saying, what is this example? What does Allah really mean by this? This could only confuse people. This could only create confusion. Some people could be misled, and those are the many, and some may be guided. يُضِلُّ بِهِ كَثِيرًا وَيَهْدِي بِهِ كَثِيرًا وَمَا يُضِلُّ بِهِ. Allah is saying, إِلَّا الْفَاسِقِينَ. Only the disobedient, only the rebellious ones who are going to be misled. They are going to take it in the wrong way and mislead themselves. They would mislead themselves. And I want to explain the term يُضِلُّ بِهِ مَنْ يَشَاءُ. Does Allah actually mislead people? No. Allah guides. Allah guides. What about the ayat that says, قُلْ إِنَّ اللَّهَ يُضِلُّ مَنْ يَشَاءُ وَيَهْدِي مَنْ يَشَاءُ. As if you take it literally, it would mean that he misleads. But that's not what the ayah is saying. What happens is, Allah gives you the choice. And He shows you what choice is good and what choice is bad. وَهَدَيْنَاهُ النَّجْدَيْنِ. We give Him the two paths, the two routes. Then when you choose deliberately to go in the wrong path, right? Don't blame Allah for your choice. You chose where to go. Where does it come that Allah يُضِلُّ مَنْ يَشَاءُ? It is by exposing a choice before you, and when you pick the wrong choice, you have been misleading yourself. And you have been misleading those who follow you. And that's why following in the Quran is very, very serious. What person do you follow? What person you take as your leader? Because their fate will become your fate. Their destiny will become your destiny. So you have to be careful. So yudillu doesn't mean that Allah actively pursues somebody's misguidance. This is the job of the shaitan, not Allah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala guides. When you make a choice among the two choices between before you that Allah offers you, Allah offers you guidance in the right direction, right? But Allah allows the shaitan to give you guidance in the wrong direction. فَإِنَّهُ talking about the shaitan, فَإِنَّهُ يُضِلُّهُ. Shaitan would definitely mislead you. Then, وَيَهْدِيهِ إِلَى صِرَاطِ الْجَحِيمِ. If you follow the shaitan, he would mislead you and he would lead you to صِرَاطِ الْجَحِيمِ, the path of hellfire. So it is not Allah who is misguiding. Allah offers you the right guidance and allows the shaitan to offer you the path to hellfire. And he gives you warning and he tells you, don't listen to shaitan. So when you follow the shaitan, it is not Allah who misled you. It is you who have taken a choice. وَيَهْدِي بِهِ كَثِيرًا. And he guides many with it. وَمَا يُضِلُّ بِهِ إِلَّا الْفَاسِقِينَ. Why is it that the fasiqeen, the rebellious, disobedient ones, are the ones who are always misled in the text of the Quran? وَاللَّهُ لَا يَهْدِي الْقَوْمَ الْفَاسِقِينَ. Repeatedly mentioned in the Quran. Why? Because what is fisq? Fisq is to get out of something. Like when a seed gets out of a shell, it's called fasaqat, which means the shell has cracked and the seed is coming out. That's fasaqa. So fisq is to exit out of the protection that Allah has given you. What is the protection? The protection is taqwa. And the word taqwa means that, protection. Qu anfusakum means protect yourself. Qu anfusakum wa ahlikum nar. That's protection. So, قُوْ أَنفُسَكُمْ اتَّقُوا اللَّهِ. It is all about protection. So what is فَاسِقِينَ? فَاسِقِينَ is one or ones who crack with their own hands and have an opening to exit from that shell. This is why they are called فَاسِقِينَ. Okay? You see what is pistachio. You see the pistachio? When it cracks open a little bit and then you complete the opening to get what? To get the nut from inside. So what you have here is a person who is given a shell in the form of the faith and the guidance of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. When you crack it open because you want to get out of it, you're not comfortable in it, you're not happy in your own skin as a Muslim, then that is called fisq, which means you want to get out of line, out of protection. The most vivid example given about that is given in Surah Al-A'raf, and I have gone over this several times, so I'll just point it out. أو كالذي no, the one الذي آتيناه آياتنا فانسلخ منها. انسلخ, someone whom we have given our ayat, so the ayat become his protection. فَانْسَلَخَ, he skinned himself off of it. He took off that protection. يَا بَنِي آدَمَ قَدْ أَنْزَلْنَا عَلَيْكُمْ لِبَاسًا يُوَارِي سَوْآتِكُمْ وَرِيشًا. Most people read this ayah and they think about physical coverage. But the ayat are not physical. The ayat are not physical. The ayat are real protection and they act like the skin for the body. When you, for the soul, when you skin it off of yourself, you become exposed. That is fisq. So al-fasiqoon are people who are not comfortable in their own skin as Muslims, and they want to take it off to become whatever they want, to do whatever they want. In other words, what many people call freedom. Islam cherishes freedom, but freedom in the correct understanding. But here, freedom from protection is not really freedom. It's like if you're getting in a fight and you're getting to the battlefield and you have your shield, you have your helmet, you have your armory, right? When you take it off, you are surrendering your protection. You are exposing yourself to get hurt, injured, or killed. So when we do away with the guidance of Allah, we do exactly that. What is the purpose? We want to live free. These are heavy, right? The armories are heavy, but they are your protection, okay? But Allah said, don't think of my protection as heavy or difficult. It's meant for your protection. And Allah promised to make it easy for you. فَسَنُوَيَسِّرُهُ لِلْيُسْرَ We will make his path easy to that which is easy, which is paradise. So, وَمَا يُضِلُّ بِهِ إِلَّا الْفَاسِقِينَ is a warning. And al-fasiqeen is a group of people that we have not spoken about. We spoke about the believers, right? We spoke about the disbelievers. We spoke about the munafiqeen, the hypocrites. Now is another category. Where does this category fall? Fasiqeen are people who run away from the guidance of Allah and the protection of His guidance, whether they are believers or non-believers. So you could find somebody who is a disbeliever, but he looks to do the right thing. He has manners, he has ethics, he has values that are not inconsistent with Islam, right? And you could find a Muslim whose lifestyle is a lifestyle of disobedience and rebellion against Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So that category could include believers, and it could include also non-believers. Here is the description of those fasiqeen. What do they do? الَّذِينَ يَنْقُضُونَ عَهْدَ اللَّهِ مِنْ بَعْدِ مِيثَاقِهِ It is those who, after taking an oath or giving a covenant to Allah, what do? They break away from that covenant. This is the element of fisq. After they make a commitment to Allah, they break away from that commitment. After they marry, based on the book and the sunnah, they break away from the book, they break away from the sunnah, and they turn their family life into hell. Why? Because they don't like it the way it is. Or they don't want to put the effort. They don't want to learn. They don't want to be bound by rules other than their own. That is fisq. So when the push comes to shove, they break their promises. الَّذِينَ يَنْقُضُونَ عَهْدَ اللَّهِ مِنْ بَعْدِ مِيثَاقِهِ وَيَقْطَعُونَ مَا أَمَرَ اللَّهُ بِهِ أَنْ يُوصَلْ And they disconnect what Allah had ordered to be joined. There's a lot of talk, and we all know it, about connecting your relatives, your kin, your family, no matter how far they are. And some of us, unfortunately, are not doing good in that box. Some of us ignore our relatives and only remember them sometimes when it is a crisis, sometimes when we need them, sometimes when we have something to get from them. This is not good. Allah ordered us to be good to our kin. وَأُولُو الْأَرْحَامِ بَعْضُهُمْ أَوْلَى بِبَعْضٍ فِي كِتَابِ اللَّهِ The kin are closer to each other, and they are deserving more of your kinship than anyone else. You know that in the early days of Medina, before the ayat of inheritance came down, the companions used to be joined together as brothers in Islam. So the Ansar would welcome the Muhajirin. They will treat them as their physical blood brothers. And they would inherit each other. And they would share positions and property until the ayat of inheritance came, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made his own divine distribution based on his knowledge and wisdom, and that practice was stopped. And Allah said, no, the kin deserve more of their kin than the stranger. Okay? So the brotherhood in Islam continued, but without inheritance. The blood brotherhood and blood kin became the heirs for the deceased. So الَّذِينَ يَنْقُضُونَ عَهَدَ اللَّهِ مِنْ بَعْدِ مِيثَاقِهِ وَيَقْطَعُونَ مَا أَمَرَ اللَّهُ بِهِ أَنْ يُوصَلَ. Al-faqir is someone that we are ordered to connect. Al-yateem is someone that we are ordered to connect. The underprivileged, the weak, the exploited are people that we are ordered to connect with. The homeless, all of these categories are our responsibility. When we disconnect them, when we don't seek them out to ask about them and to offer them the help. And some of us may say, but I don't have help to offer. This guy needs money. That's okay. Check on him. Check on his kids. Maybe you will find when you check that you have much more than what he does and that you could spare a few dollars to help. And even after all, if you decided and you found sincerely that you don't have any extra money to give, as the hadith would say, then maybe you could urge someone who has resources to extend this help to that person. What does the Quran call this? The Quran, in blaming those who disconnect these categories, Allah says, وَلَا تَحَاضُّونَ عَلَىٰ طَعَامِ الْمِسْكِينَ. And why don't you urge each other, if you don't have the resources to help directly, why don't you just seek out someone who has resources and tell him, look at this brother. You're driving 10 cars and this guy is homeless. Give him some help. Give him a job if you can. Give him some money. Invite him for dinner. Invite him for lunch. That if you could not do it yourself. So there is no excuse that we leave these categories to die in the midst of a Muslim community. Then beyond that, those fasiqoon, they don't only disconnect the kin and the poor and those categories, but وَيُفْسِدُونَ فِي الْأَرْضِ. So what kind of facade is referred to here? Any kind of facade. But in that context, it is about somebody who has disconnected his own kin. He's angry with his brother or sister or anybody, and he doesn't talk to them for years. And you come to him and tell him, I have a problem with my sister. I have a problem with my in-laws. And says, oh, do you know what? I killed that problem 10 years ago. I'm not connected to my sister. She's like yours. That is fasad. That is not fasad. That is ifsad. So they don't only do what is wrong, they encourage others to follow suit. And how many of us do this casually and on a daily basis? I use myself as the best example. With all my sins and awful transgression, I say, I do this, I would do this, as if I am the standard. You are not the standard. The standard is the Quran. But when we set ourselves up as the example, we end up corrupting instead of reforming and correcting. So we have to be careful. وَيُفْسِدُونَ فِي الْأَرْضِ. Corrupt people and rebellious people and disobedient people, therefore, we are told, do not obey them. وَلَا تُطِعْ مَنْ اتَّبَعَ هَوَاهُ. وَاصْبِرْ نَفْسَكَ مَعَ الَّذِينَ يَدْعُونَ رَبَّهُمْ بِالْغَدَاةِ وَالْعَشِيِّ يريدون وجهه ولا تعد عيناك عنهم تريد زينة الحياة الدنيا ولا تطع من أغفلنا قلبه عن ذكرنا واتبع هواه. Don't obey the one whose heart is inattentive to our guidance and he is following his whims and desires. Don't follow him. Don't even take him as a friend. Because if you do, he will be your closest advisor. And if he keeps advising you, you're bound to listen one time, or two, or ten. So, وَلَا تُطِعْ مَنْ أَغْفَلْنَا قَلْبَهُ. Don't let a corrupt person corrupt you by his corruption, because he's close to you. He's my closest friend. And when your wife asks you, what did you do? Why did you do this? I asked my friends. But your friends are not friends of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They are not friends of his book and his guidance. So think twice before you pick the guidance from anyone. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala raises a question to those people, the mu'mineen, the kafireen, the rebellious ones, all of those categories. كَيْفَ تَكْفُرُونَ بِاللَّهِ. How come that you deny Allah? وَكُنْتُمْ أَمْوَاتًا فَأَحْيَاكُمْ. Before you were created, you were lifeless material. تراب, ماء, طين, lifeless material, right? فَأَحْيَاكُمْ. Allah gave you life. That's the beginning. ثُمَّ يُمِيتُكُمْ. Then he will put you to death. Then ثُمَّ يُحْيِيكُمْ. Then he will resurrect you. He will revive you. What an amazing experience. We think it's big when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala put the children of Israel, a group of them, to death and he gave them life, right? And they are still ungrateful, right? Here Allah is telling us he has done it twice for all of us. And on the day of judgment, people in hellfire will pray and ask and scream and cry to Allah, ربنا أمتنا اثنتين وأحييتنا اثنتين فاعترفنا بذنوبنا فهل إلى خروج من سبيل. Oh Allah, you've put us to death twice and you brought us to life twice. Is there a way out of hellfire? We have acknowledged our sinfulness. We've admitted our guilt. There is no way. ذلك بأنه إذا دعي الله وحده كفرتم وإن يكفر به تؤمنوا تشركوا وإن يشرك به تؤمنوا فالحكم لله العلي الكبير. So the reason they are not getting out of hellfire is if Allah alone is talking or is believed or his guidance is promoted and spread and told to you, you deny it. And if associates are attached to him as equals or partners, you believe in equals and partners, then the judgment is up to Allah. فالحكم لله العلي الكبير. How many times does someone reach out to you and tell you, brother, this is what the Quran says? And some people would answer and say, I know, but they have their own idea. That is denial of Allah. That is kufr. When you second guess the word of Allah, that is kufr. Why? Because you set yourself up as either equal or even better and more knowledgeable and more wise than your creator. ثُمَّ يُحْيِيكُمْ ثُمَّ إِلَيْهِ تُرْجَعُونَ. And then you will go back to him. The end of this whole journey is we're all going back to Allah. It's that simple. It is that simple. In the beginning, your leash was zero. You yourself was nothing but dead lifeless thing, right? شيئاً unmentioned, unremembered, okay? Very insignificant. Then Allah extended your leash. He gave you the rope, right? And He told you, hold on to that rope, that connection, to be safe. Then He keeps extending the rope to you, but then as time goes by, that rope will be pulled back into the hands of Allah. It will be pulled back, and your life will end, and you will have to stand before Allah. So what is the conclusion of this? Here you have it. A choice of belonging to the believers is yours. The choice to become a disbeliever is yours. The choice to become a believing, obedient servant is yours. The choice to become a claimer of faith but a disobedient person is yours. The choice to become a hypocrite is yours. All of these are offered to us right in the beginning of the Quran. Isn't this empowering? That from the beginning of your journey, as soon as you start reading the Quran, Allah tells you, these are the choices you have, take your pick. And to take the right pick, you have to surround yourself with the environment that would help you pick the right pick and take the right path. And that is only going to be possible if you surround yourself with the people who represent your choice. So those who surround themselves with the believers, we know their choice. Those who surround themselves with people who are frequenting the mosque, reading Quran, learning Islam, we know what their preference is. And that's why it is more true in Islam than it is according to the American culture, which says, tell me who your friends are, I tell you who you are. It is more true in Islam than it is in any culture. Because your friends are your choice. Maybe your parents may not represent you. Ibrahim, his father, didn't represent him, right? Noah, his son, didn't represent him. Lot's wife did not stand for him, right? Pharaoh didn't stand as a representative of his wife, right? And all of these are blood relatives, which we could claim genetics has an influence. But the people you choose are you. Because we all love to live a peaceful life. And it's more peaceful to live with somebody who thinks like you, believes like you, worships like you, eats like you, holds on to the same values and goals and objectives. And that's why when you get to choose a spouse, it shows what matters to you the most. May Allah guide us to the right choices. Alhamdulillah. والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله وعلى آله وصحبه ومن والاه وبعد. Brothers and sisters, as we are going through the Quran talking to us, talking about us, talking about our choices, I hope that we are enlightened and informed enough to change course and to come back to Allah. Coming back is what is called tawbah or inaba. وَأَنِيبُوا إِلَىٰ رَبِّكُمْ وَأَسْلِمُوا لَهُ. Come back to Allah and submit to Him. That's the hope. The hope is that our life tomorrow, our life next week is going to be better than last week. That our life every month is better than our life in the month before. If you are climbing the ladder of your faith, you know where you're heading. So this is the hope. This is not an intellectual exercise. This is not aimed at anything but to make the Quran simple and easy, understandable and practicable in our life so that we can benefit. Allahumma anfa'na bima 'allamtana wa 'allimna ma yanfa'una. Allahumma ihdina fi man hadayt wa 'afina fi man 'afayt وتولنا فيمن توليت، وقنا واصرف عنا شر ما قضيت. اللهم قنا واصرف عنا شر ما قضيت. اللهم اقسم لنا من خشيتك ما تحول به بيننا وبين معصيتك، ومن طاعتك ما تبلغنا به جنتك، ومن اليقين ما تهون به علينا مصائب الدنيا. ومتعنا اللهم بأسماعنا وأبصارنا وقوتنا ما أحييتنا، واجعله الوارث منا، واجعل ثأرنا على من ظلمنا، ولا تجعل مصيبتنا في ديننا، ولا تجعل الدنيا أكبر همنا ولا مبلغ علمنا، ولا إلى النار مصيرنا. وإذا أردت بقومنا فتنة فنجنا منها يا مولانا، غير خزايا ولا مفتونين ولا مبدلين ولا مغيرين. اللهم اشرح صدورنا لطاعتك. اللهم اغفر لنا ذنوبنا وإسرافنا في أمرنا، وثبت أقدامنا. اللهم انصر المجاهدين يا رب العالمين في كل مكان. اللهم انصر عبادك المجاهدين في كل مكان. اللهم انصر المظلومين والمستضعفين. اللهم عليك بالجبارين والظالمين والمعتدين، فإنهم لا يعجزونك. اللهم اقسمهم يا رب العالمين. أقول قولي هذا وأستغفر الله لي ولكم، فستذكرون ما أقول لكم، وأفوض أمري إلى الله، إن الله بصير بالعباد. وأقم الصلاة.